Well, we have, of course, our special guest tonight, Roy Lee, who is the producer of the film. Roy has actually produced a number of fantastic films that you probably have been scared by over the years. Films like The Ring and The Grudge. And then some other films also that were not necessarily horror films, but also very iconic, like The Departed. And he has also done a few things that were a little more family friendly. So he was a producer, for example, on the Lego Movie.
To the Batmobile.
This process might seem overwhelming, but with a little practice, it can soon become a pleasurable experience.
I'd love to welcome to the stage Roy Lee and our moderator, Tova Laiter. Thank you, guys.
So nice to be back in this room. It's the first in-person that I've been doing since the pandemic. So thank you all for showing up. And of course, we have to thank Roy Lee, who I'm a big admirer, and I'm sure that you are here because of his body of work that just keeps going good. That's all I can say. So, you are the master of the genre, okay? And I want to know, because I'm not going to mention again It and The Grudge, and you know, everybody knows your movie. The question is, what draws you to the genre, and when did it start? And forgive me, because you were going to say something after I said you're a master.
No, I was.
Please don't protest.
I wasn't playing. I just love horror movies. I mean, that's the type of movies I've always wanted to see. And when I was growing up, those are the movies I rented on VHS cassettes and went to the video store to get horror movies. And just it's the type of movie I don't know what attracts me. Either you like horror movies or you don't. And so that's one of the things I did. And so all the movies that I produced, most of them are the ones that when I read the script, it's like that, I want to see that type of movie.
So how did it start? Because I was like doing a little research on you, and I heard something really funny about your mother, that she sent you to see The Exorcist and The Omen because she thought it was religious movies.
She's a very religious person, and she took me to these movies. And so, yeah, I remember like very vividly the theater experience because we saw The Exorcist in the middle of the day, and it came out when I was probably like 5 years old. Whoa. And so maybe it was like five or six when I saw it.
Oh my
and
God.
So that was like one of the earlier film experience in my life, and same thing with The Omen. I love the movies, but I was a little scared after seeing them and had to sleep in their bedroom for a while.
Okay, so we all kind of try to recreate our childhood traumas.
Yes.
That's all I can say, psychologically speaking. We want to ask you a lot of questions about The Barbarian, but first, how did you start in the business?
I got a job at a film production company called Alphaville.
And sure. Sean Daniels.
Sean
right?
Daniels and Jim Jacks. And it was more of a, I just happened to get the job. Like I had driven across, because I'm from DC, driven across, this was 96, like September 96. And I got here on a Thursday. I had general meetings with people through connections I had from back home. And one of them was, one of the people was a VP at Alphaville, and she was just meeting me as a favor because I knew her father-in-law from back home, and she was just a little frustrated at the time because she didn't like her assistant at the time, and she was like, "I'm firing my assistant tomorrow. If you want to get a job, like started a film, see what a film company's like, you could start Monday if you want." And so I just said, "Sure," and started working there the following week.
Okay, so tell me how you're very entrepreneurial. So you started something called tracking, which when I was an executive, it was already in, you know, because of you, I suppose, we all started to like, you know, all our PAs and assistants and so on and so forth would track all the scripts that are available, the spec scripts. And tell us a little bit about that.
Well, that was one of the things they asked me to do, is because as you might have never remembered from back then, it's like tracking was mainly done via phone calls and maybe emails to exchange information. And then you would put together a little report or a document just to share with the producers of the company of like all the material that's available that week, and sometimes log lines, sometimes the coverage, and just like all the information they need on each project that's available. And it would take the full day for most of the other people, because you do it on the side, just like constantly calling one person after another, like at least 20 different
right.
people. And it was just seemed so inefficient. And I was like, there's got to be, and this is like pre-Facebook days, and I was like, we could create an IP address and put a database there, and so that anyone of us could access the same document. And so just had groups of 25 in one group, it was all password protected, and we'd all create one document between the 25 people so that all of us could just edit the document ourselves and then print it out ourselves. And it would just take what took 6 to 8 hours a day to like 15, 20 minutes a day.
Okay. So that's what I'm saying. What year was that? I'm just
This was
curious.
In 97. 1997. Yeah. So it was very early in the internet days of there wasn't Facebook, and there was maybe...
No,
it was
I
called
remember.
GeoCities was the only thing which was a real pain.
Yeah. No, because I remember our assistants, you know, used to basically do that job, and then, you know, come weekend read or before, they'll just say, so-and-so CIA sending out the spec script, and we should all get on it, and all that stuff. And then you created another app, Scriptchart.
That was just different variations of the name of the thing, because I ended up selling the whole service, because it was by the time I was done, because like everyone saw how efficient our one group was doing, and so people wanted to have either join our group, which we couldn't have too much, because then having the information too widely disseminated makes it sort of meaningless. And so I just told people, if you get together your own group of 25, I'll create another duplicate on this. And so after a while, there was over 600 people using 600 people in groups of 25 that were using this sort of IP address to have databases themselves.
Okay, so it got sold to the New York Times, right?
Eventually, it ended up with the New York Times. Yes.
I see. Why would the New York Times buy it? It's so specific about the movie business and scripts.
I don't know, because it was sold to iFilm, and then was a thing, and then iFilm was acquired by someone else, and so it was like part of a bigger package of other.
I see. Did you have any ownership of it?
No, they just paid me cash at the time.
Okay. So was that enough cash to...
At the time, I'll just say it, $750,000. And it was, at the time, I thought it was like the most money I've ever seen in one time. So I was just
that's
like...
That's the most I've seen in one
okay,
time.
Okay, well, that it was just like...
And that's now.
Yeah. And I just decided to sort of take some time off and figure out what I wanted to do.
Okay, so then you went... And you worked for Bender Spinks, and then you basically got your own company. Or maybe during Bender Spinks, you convinced the Asian rights owner of The Ring.
That was during the time, because it was actually, Bender Spinks was a management company, and
yes.
I wasn't a manager, and they were actually, they had offices, and they said, do you want to run your business out of our office?
See.
And because I was, before that, I was just staying in my apartment, and so it was there, and they're like, in exchange for credit, like if projects you set up will be attached to as well, and so.
So my question is, how did you convince, the rights holders of The Ring to give you the rights for remake? I'm saying that because this is an educational thing.
the situation for The Ring was a very unusual one where I had seen the movie, I didn't actually have the rights, and the vice president, or he wasn't vice president at the time, but when I was watching it, a friend of mine who was working at a film festival, it was shared some of their, it was an Asian film festival, some of their movies in the festival. And she was just sending things just to show me some things that they showed. And I didn't want to watch it myself. And I just called a friend, Mark Surian, who was at DreamWorks at the time. I was telling him about the movie. And he's like, I'll watch it. And so we ended up watching it together. And then the next day, he told his boss about it. And his boss said, well, let's just pick up the remake rights. And so then we had to backtrack and call the rights holder and say, DreamWorks wants to make an offer on the rights. And so it was something where I didn't control anything until after DreamWorks paid for it.
Right. So, because that was the system in the old days, basically, you know, you had a connection at the studio, and if you showed them something that they like, they bought it for you, they protected you, they made your deal, there was kind of an honor system. So do you think, and then what was the next movie that you did that you had to buy the rights from, the remake rights from somebody who owned the rights?
Well, the Ring went so fast into production. It was definitely under a year from seeing the movie to starting production.
Unbelievable.
And I was also working normally as reading scripts, reading books and yes. articles. And I just saw how fast that was going. And I was like, this has got to be the better way of doing it than setting up original scripts or yeah. other things. And so I had actually just called the producer of The Ring and said, what else do you have? And he sent me Ju-on, which was The Grudge. And so it wasn't like I even had to ask for it. He was already happy to have gotten, he got paid $1.3 million for the rights of, for the remake rights of The Ring.
Wow.
And the budget of the movie was like $1.1 million. So, and it was already a hit in Japan. So he already made his money back on home video as well. And so it was found money for him. And when I said, do you have anything else? He's like, sure, here's this. See if you can do anything with that. Didn't have subtitles. It was a little bit hard to find a screenwriter to want to try to adapt a movie without subtitles, and it was very disjointed. So, but there was this one writer, Steven Sesko, who was like, I'll just make it up. And so he just watched the movie, made up what he thought the story was,
yes.
and pitched the version of the movie that ended up partnering with Sam Raimi to do.
And how did it happen?
It happened because Dan Lin was a studio executive at the time, and this was after The Ring and The Grudge, and he's like, is there any horror movie that we have in our library? And at the time, he didn't even know, like, Warner Brothers didn't even realize they owned the rights to
sure.
it, and because it was through a home video company that they had acquired years before, and because I always wanted to do it, and so when I talked to Rand, his agent, he's like, we don't own the rights to that, and I just had to figure out who actually owned the rights, and it was just lucky that it was Warner Brothers, and so Dan was able to just pull the rights from their own subsidiary to start.
And now, of course, you had reputation for somebody who can do those movies very well,
yes.
and so it was easier from there on. So easy that I want to tell you that I looked you up on IMDb Pro. And for this year only, 2022, there's 3 releases, 6 movies in post-production, and 2 filming. So you are the most prolific producer that I know. And some of them are with other producers. What is your philosophy as a producer?
My philosophy is to work with anyone who has an ability to get movies made, and just working with friends is another thing, and anyone who's helping push the project forward or has either the rights or just the the desire of because they love the script and they're just behind it. And so, because you know, I can't be on everything, and so it's good to have partners on things. And it's just a matter of putting the movies together that feel like they keep on moving forward.
Yeah, that's amazing. Because some people would say, well, if there's other people, I don't really want to do it. I want to be the sole producer. I want to be this. But you basically have a different philosophy, which obviously really works for
you. Yeah, it's whatever you get the movie made.
Okay, so how did you get involved with two movies that don't seem to be your genre? One is The Departed, and the other one, get this, people, it's called Don't Worry, Darling, and it has Harry Styles in it. And when is it going to be released?
This Friday.
Okay. So how did you get involved in that? Because they don't seem to be your...
Yeah. Starting with The Departed, it was a movie called Infernal Affairs. And that one started through the process of... Taka was the producer of The Ring and The Grudge, and they were both made in less than a year of starting development, and he got paid significantly more for Ju-on or The Grudge, and it was also a worldwide hit, and a lot of other producers and studios in Asia went to him and said, how did you get two of your movies made into Hollywood productions? Right. And he told them, if you want your movie made, you should send it to Roy. And so it was a nice thing for him to do. So then after that, I was just inundated with video cassettes and just submissions of like projects that are in development or in production in Asia. And Infernal Affairs was just another VHS cassette that came in a box of other things.
Was it Departed?
Yeah. And so
what was the original movie?
It was a Chinese movie called Infernal Affairs.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, I remember that.
Yeah. And so it was another one where I saw it and I was like, it's obviously a movie that could be set in the U.S. and remade.
And then it wins 3 Oscars.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. And just a little thing that happened. Okay.
And then Don't Worry, Darling was a spec script that was just sent to me and written by Dick Van Dyke's grandkids. And it was just a really well-written, like a nice story, and I just really liked it. It was much more of a thriller before Olivia came aboard. And so like once we got the script to a place to start sharing it with people, Olivia read it and wanted to direct it. And so then it all started to be built upon her having come off of Booksmart.
And how many months did that take until production? It usually takes 10 years,
yeah,
okay?
It took under a year, so, yeah.
This is so crazy.
Yeah.
Amazing. So, obviously, you have, beside being kind of entrepreneurial and a great salesman, probably, you also know how to, you have... an ability to put the right elements together for the movie to come together, because we have been at the studio and you know you can go through like 5 drafts and it ends up nowhere. And from what you are telling us here, it looks like all the right choices were made. So the adaptation scripts were good. The directors that came aboard were good. All of that. So how did The Barbarian come together?
That was another spec script that actually had been floating around for a long time. And it actually came to my company too, and we had passed on it. And it wasn't until these younger producers who were attached to it sent it to me saying, I have to read it. And it was actually because it was one of the first things they sent me, and I always give a person the first shot of like, and so I actually read it without having it covered like I normally do through the company, and I really liked it. And so as soon as I finished it, I was like, we'd got to get this thing made.
I heard that it was turned down by many companies.
Every company, yes.
Why do you think that was? Because of the structure of 3 chapters?
Yeah, it was the tonal shifts of the the time when it's cuts to the mother's first appearance to Justin Long's character on the beach, everyone thought it was, no one would understand it, and it would be too jarring for the audience, and it just wasn't a movie, and it was a sort of like a anthology, and I was like, it's not an anthology, it's all connected, it's all like a puzzle piece that comes together.
It's like the movie that Tarantino and Robert Rodriguez did together. I don't remember the name of it, but it was with the vampire, and it was like three...
From Dusk Till Dawn, yeah.
Yeah, and it was fantastic. So it takes really...
And there's also was a director attached who had co-directed a movie that was slightly underwhelming, which was called Miss March. And it was, the company that ended up financing it didn't realize he had directed something before until after they had greenlit the movie. And they're like, Roy, you didn't tell us he directed this movie. I was like, well, you didn't ask. So it's, but yeah. So it was just tough with having a director who had done a fairly unsuccessful film. And
I see. So that was a factor also.
Which is why we only, at the time, had a budget of $3.5 million to make it. New Regency said there's no way that you could film the movie that you just saw for $3.5 million, so they gave us $4.5 million.
Give $4.5 million.
Yeah.
Okay, that's a little more than
And the head of the studio even told the director, "Is like $4.5 million, even if the movie's a piece of shit, doesn't matter. We won't lose that much because the streaming sales." And so he was very unhappy with that comment, but he still made the movie.
Let's just say you have a script and everybody turns it down for whatever reason. When do you keep going with it, decide to keep going, and when do you say, you know what, it's just not worth the effort, it's time to basically quit and move on? It's a tough question.
It's depending on the scripts. Yeah, it's. I guess if it doesn't get made, I expect every project that's in development not to get made, actually, because the conversion rate of development from the studio to actually getting made was under 5%, and so I just put things together that I hope will work and see where they end up. And every now and then I'll focus on a script that I really want to get made, which was Barbarian was the last one. And you just have to pick your horses that you want to really back. And this is one of them.
And the 5% that get made are all your movies, because you have 3 in release, 6 in post-production, and 2 filming, right? Everything else, there's no room, because Roy Lee basically gets all of them done. Unbelievable. So, students, this is for you to learn from the master. So whoever wants to ask a question, and I suggest you should, don't be shy, because then you'll come home and you say, I should have asked that question. It's for you to learn. And whoever wants to ask a question, please go to the back. There's a microphone there. And yes.
My question is a bit straightforward. So how long did it take you to do the movie in general, pre-production, production, post-production? And what was the hard thing that you had doing the project with you and your team?
On Barbarian?
Barbarian, yeah.
It was... less than a year ago that we were prepping the movie, and I think it was 30 shooting days in Bulgaria, and we finished it in about 8 months from start to finish. But getting the financing was the trickier part that took more than a year.
So my question is on a more general scale, for as a script like Barbarian, as you said, it was a script that wasn't really attracting a lot of many people. So how, as a producer, do you go and, as you just said, that it was a year-long process for financing the film itself. So how and how do you pitch to people that I have a script and, you don't tell them that it's not really that good, but it's how do you convince them to give you the money for a script like this, where you know already that people are not going for it. So you have to believe in it to a certain level, but how do you make someone else believe in it so much that they give you money to finance it?
I just have to find people who haven't read it before and hope that they will read it and decide that they want to do it. And this situation in this case was, it's if you listen to the Big Picture podcast, and Zach Krieger talks about it, where this was put together in less than a weekend, where you read and see. I sort of gave it to him on a Friday, told him they have to read it, and they had not even heard of it. And I said, you have to make a decision in 24 hours, or you can't make the movie. Doing that made them pay more attention to it, think about it in a shorter period of time, and decide to say yes right away. But before that, when people were given time to analyze the script and decide to do it, then they all passed. So just doing it.
So that's one of the tricks that we learned today.
Yeah, but it wasn't thought out.
It's like everybody passed, and there's one person that says that maybe can say yes, and he's like saying to them, millions of people want it, but I'm going to give it to you this weekend.
Yeah.
But you have to make a quick decision. Okay. And how did you pitch it to them? What was the one-line or two-line pitch for The Barbarian?
It's hard to pitch. I just said it's an amazing script that will be remembered for years to come as a horror movie classic. That was it.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Ryan. Congratulations on the movie.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Kieran, and I have a question about hiring a crew. Obviously, with the film, there are two different locations. One is mostly based in Detroit, Michigan, but also based in Los Angeles as well for a little bit. When you were creating or hiring the crew, was there a decision to either just primarily focus on getting people from Detroit and people in Michigan for those scenes, or was there priority, or as a producer, would you rather have hiring crew from like LA and then bring them to a place like Michigan for the film?
This movie was entirely shot in Bulgaria with a Bulgarian crew. And we did have one day in Detroit for some exterior shots of her walking in the street when she was just to show like the neighborhood and her driving in the car. So that was one day, and then there was just one day in LA for Justin to do that one shot on PCH. But other than that, everything was on stage or in a field in Bulgaria, where we built the whole neighborhood on the street. In the field, all the houses and everything.
Okay, all right, that's my question. Thank you so much.
Really?
Okay.
So you didn't use Avi Lerner's place?
No.
Wow. So what is, do you think, so the $4.5 million was good shooting in Bulgaria? If you had to shoot it here, it would have been
at least $15 million.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, we're moving there.
And the crews were amazing. Like,
really?
Like we couldn't believe because when they said they're building the street of Detroit on a field in just Sofia, we were like, all right, well, I'm sure we'll have to do a lot. But when we got there, it looked like we just sent videos of driving on a street that we wanted to do. And they recreated the street in 3 weeks.
And the meeting in the building that was in Detroit between her and the documentary, or was it in Sofia?
Sofia.
Hi, my name is Brady. I noticed that you have a pretty diverse body of work as far as genres go. And so I was curious as to what you would say some of the challenges and some of the advantages to producing horror films specifically compared to other genres.
Horror films are actually easier to get made if the scripts are great. And just because you could also make them for a lower budget and you don't necessarily need stars. And because like Georgina was an amazing find in this movie where we just saw her on an episode of Black Mirror and really liked her. And she did an amazing job. And so we're actually casting her in our next movie. So it's really, that with horror movies, it's easier. And it's it just, it's all about great scripts. And so we're either you have a strong piece of IP that then you don't necessarily have to have the greatest script, but if you don't, if it's an original, it always has to be amazing.
Cool, thank you.
Yeah.
Hello, Mr. Lee, thank you. Aside from the script and talent, what is the one thing that you find pushes you over the goal line to get it financed?
What pushes it over the edge? I mean, those are the two important things, and the director, and a budget that is semi-reasonable. I guess, yeah, it's just having a group of people, being from the studio executives to the creative people involved, just really wanting to see the movie made. It's not necessarily just for a job or to make money, it's to actually see the specific story. So it's just like a communal belief in just the making of this movie.
Do you feel like you learned anything from this project that you'll take to future projects?
Well, each time there's a different learning experience. I learned that Sofia is an amazing place to shoot, and I told the director of the next movie that he should really consider Sofia, and he checked it out and said sure, he wanted to do it there.
Awesome. Thank you.
I have a question before you go there. Excuse me, before I forget it. And I already forgot it. So when you're looking for a director to a horror movie, do you go to the pool of directors that already have done horror movies or have done short horror movies or just any good director? What is it that you're looking for when you try? Because you had like an amazing, you know, score of like finding really good directors for the movies. So that's why I'm asking.
It varies from time to time, because like sometimes if you just have the script, then you would send it out and you'll get many calls and they'll do presentations. Some people do rip reels.
You send it to the agents?
Yes, the agencies.
The managers.
Yeah, or the studio would put it out there as an open directing assignment, and then they would get solicited all these different
ideas. Have you done a movie where you don't have the backing and you can still send it to the agents and say, I need a director, I don't have the financing yet, but I need a director?
All the time. I mean, it's especially of ones that we're thinking of putting together.
Right.
It's like with some spec scripts where even before that we even send it to buyers, some agents will say, what do you plan on trying to submit to studios? And then like our last script that we took out was called Below, that David the agency knew that we wanted to do it and send it to David Sandberg, who was directing Shazam at the time, and he read it immediately and said he wanted to attach, and then it was a bigger sale for the script than if he wasn't attached. So, and the same thing with Don't Worry Darling was getting Olivia Wilde attached was before we took it to any potential studio.
Oh, wow. And she got all that cast. So you're going to have a movie called Below, but this movie was below in the basement.
It's more like a movie called They Live and The Hidden.
I see.
With sci-fi horror.
Just trying to be a little funny about this. So.
Well, Disney almost made us change the title of this to Get the Fuck Out, and which is they wanted it. They thought it'd be like an eye-catching title, and well, the F. You know, with the words and stuff, but they thought it fit the tone of this movie and might have done better if it was that title,
sure.
But our director wanted the Barbarian title.
Oh, I would fire the director and get the title.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you so much for coming, Mr. Lee. I was just wondering, as a producer, what's your advice to young screenwriters who have like an original script on how to market it and catch the eye of producers, get it sold?
Yeah, it's tough because there are so many scripts being written and it's so hard to get through the system because there's many different layers of getting it to the people that actually make the decisions. The one thing you should not do is go to the person that makes the decisions and try to get them to read, because the people have I have a stack of 20 scripts that I want to read, but I can only, like, I've just broken it down to just one script a day, because if I read more than one, I get the storylines mixed up, especially in the same genre. It's, so it's like befriending one of the junior people at the company, or someone who's junior at an agency who could start championing it to push it through, because it's like the building of the interest of, like, people talking about it can then lead it to it being read by more and more people. But it's like it takes a lot of luck and timing for the right people, because, you know, it takes an hour at least for anyone to read it, and everyone has a stack of scripts anyways that they at any given point. So it's and those people who are starting out at the company are, they want to make a name for themselves, so they do really want to find great scripts so they could be the one to help push it through. So, and they'll read your script if they like you and they're friendly with you. So so if you have quality work and you have those connections with those people to read it, then it's the only really way to get it through. So, because, like, even Barbarian, if it didn't go to this company called Boulderlight, who then pushed it for me to read, and just, like, they were very persistent in trying, like, telling, like, every day, it's like, did you read the script? Did you read the script? And I finally just read it. And so it wouldn't have happened.
And how did they get through to you, basically?
I just had a general meeting with them, and they've been doing a lot of small indie under $1 million movies, and they wanted to see if they could figure out how to do a studio movie.
I see. I think that what Roy is saying, I really think it's really, really important, because students, when they start out, they really want to get to the person on top of the chain, and you're not going to get anywhere with that, you know? So even when I worked and people knew the owner of the company, and they'll have meeting with him, and he said, yeah, 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 yeah. And then, of course, the minute they left, he would ring me or anybody else in the company and say, read that script. And I would have more invested in a script if somebody sent it to me directly, because, you know, then if it works, it's glory for me. So I would say to student that what he's telling you is really a very, very sound advice. Go to the junior people. They're just like you. They want to really, you know, go up in the chain, and they are looking for good material. And you do much better. Much better going to those people. And then you also create a network with people like you, and everybody is rising up. The screenwriters, the directors, the agent, the manager, and now you have your little group. So do that. Sometimes the assistant, you know, in an agency, make friends with them. And that's the way to do it.
Yeah, because all these people want to find great scripts. They want to be the person that discovers somebody.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. And thank you for giving the world Barbarian and Lego Movie.
You're welcome.
Yeah, I forgot to ask you about the Lego movies.
Hi. I actually did want to ask you about the Lego Movie. I was wondering how that you came to that whole project.
That one was a situation where it was... Dan Lin was a studio executive at the studio at Warner Brothers, and we were just talking about big franchises to put together. And I had actually been playing the Lego Star Wars game, and I really enjoyed, just because it was a very simple, fun game. And then there were all the other Lego games were based on a specific movie, for like Harry Potter. And I was thinking, why couldn't there just be an original story that was essentially a video game? So I would say Lego Movie was one of the first video game movies that wasn't based on an actual game. And so I just called the Lego company in Carlsbad and asked for their licensing department and to see if they wanted to try to develop it as a feature film.
That's awesome. Thank you.
Hi. I was just wondering, is your company hiring at all?
I don't think so at the time. We're pretty staffed up right now.
All right, cool. And then also, at what point in your life did you think that, like, thought to yourself that you made it?
Oh, what point did I feel like I made it?
Yeah, like, you realized.
I mean, it was probably, I was just very bullish after the first two movies that were hit movies that seemed to be very easy to put together, which was The Ring and The Grudge. And then after that, a bunch of, I had at the time set up about 25 Asian remakes, thinking that if I could get one of those made, which is like the 5% of those after The Ring, and I got 18 of them made. And so that was, it was.
Okay, this guy is not from this world, I'll tell you right now. He's some alien who came here, one of those barbarians who just kind of sneaked in, and he works among us, but we don't understand really how he gets it all done. It's unbelievable. Okay.
Thank you.
Hi, I really appreciate it that you made a Japanese movie to the American version because I'm from Tokyo. I was thinking I should ask some technician question about producing because I'm producing program, but I cannot be try to be smart. So my question is, have you ever, do you believe in ghosts because you made so many scary movies? Because I'm so scared to make the scary movies. Do you have any experience on the set or usual?
No, I mean, I don't not believe in them. I don't believe in them. I mean, I have been in situations where I've been scared, not necessarily because there's a ghost, but I mean, that I just like to be put in those situations to be scared. So it's whatever it takes to scare me is like what I'd like to either put on screen or just experience myself. Like the biggest disappointment for the Barbarian for me is not being able to see it fresh eyes for the first time because I had read the script from the beginning because I just love that feeling. But like when I read it, it definitely scared me. But I know that had I just seen the movie, I'd be much more scared than with what we had done. But I could never get that experience.
Oh.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
It's like saying, I have so much money, but I really can't enjoy it now. I just remembered the first million. I was so excited.
Well, no, this is different. This is a scary experience that you can't recreate.
Yeah. But at least you gave us all the thrills of being scared.
Yes.
So you should really feel good about
that. Yeah, I mean, that's the mentality of trying to put together any of these movies now, is that you hope that your movie in 25 years will be one of the few of that year that people remember. Because like you see, I don't know how many other people see. I probably see 50 to 100 movies a year, any given year. And maybe in 5 years, I'll remember 10 of them, of like distinctly remembering them. And then like in 25, maybe one or two. And it's just like always trying to get them to make those movies that everyone's gonna remember years from now. Or the ones that will inspire other people when they want to start building their film career, like The Exorcist or Evil Dead, or one of those movies for me, remembering growing up, that this movie will inspire somebody like 25 years later, like, I love this movie, Barbarian, which I actually think is gonna be because of the response. This movie gave me a bigger response than any other movie.
Really?
Yeah.
Huh, interesting, okay.
Hello, Mr. Lee. I actually had a quick question for you about the post-production process on your project here. Was there any difficult decisions that you had to make during like the editing of it? Like, were there any scenes that you wish stayed in, or was there any hard decisions that you kind of had to make that kind of got left on the cutting room floor or anything like that?
I was actually trying to get him to cut more out of this movie, but there's a couple of scenes that it was a tough choice for him to cut out. It was much grosser than you saw here, because I just don't like to see that much like violence in the movie. And there's this some really crazy scenes that we shot that he will have an NC-17 rated version at some point in the future. So,
oh, really?
But I actually was at some point and I'm glad he won that argument, is to cut the 80s section where with Richard Brake. I was like, I didn't know if that was gonna work. I thought that could have been one too many time shifts, but he shot it and it worked, and I'm glad we shot it because I was trying to get him not to shoot it so we could cut it out of our budget.
Oh man, that's crazy. Well, thank you. Thank you.
Hello, sir. Congratulations for the Barbarian. My question is that during the pandemic, everyone thought like, okay, the theater experience is getting dead. And how are you guys planning to, you know, revive the theatrical experience, especially with the horror movies?
Yeah, it was always in a decline. It was going to be in decline regardless of whether or not there was a pandemic, but it just sort of accelerated that. But it's slowly building back up because it's more about the, you know, when they say it's like a streaming war, or it's actually an attention war where everyone has podcasts, radio, TV, movies, internet, social media, and there's only so much that people can actually consume, and it's a finite pie. And so it's always just trying to get the attention of people to see it in theaters, because it's an additional step that younger viewers as they grow up are harder to do. So it's just a matter of like upping the game to make things more exciting for them in terms of like either bigger budgeted Marvel movies or smaller, innovative horror movies that can elicit an experience from the audience that is different. So that's why I really wanted to do this movie, because I felt like it's one of these things that people will just experience in a different way in a theater than had you just watched it at home with your computer and headphones.
I mean, the comedy moments were just, you know, so obvious, you know, and the whole, oh my God, don't go to the basement, right? All that stuff.
Yeah, when people see it with a larger audience that are very vocal, then it's like that enhances the viewing.
Yeah, this is what happened, you know, when we saw it here. So it was great. Anything else?
Another follow-up question. So when you see like a bunch of horror scripts that comes to you on the table and then you don't know what to pick, and is there like a checklist for you that, you know, you know, if I have these boxes to be checked, it makes a good horror film?
No, it's just when I read it and there's a movie I want to see, is it. It's because this one doesn't have, like, I couldn't say what checks the box on this one. It's so weird and different. And it's just when I read it, it's like I could just picture it in my mind and think that if I saw that on the screen, I would really appreciate it.
Thank you so much, sir.
Sure thing.
So, we still have one. Wonderful. Oh, we have two. Thank you.
My question is, when you and your team were starting the pre-production process, was there any other horror movies that you used as inspiration for this one?
It was, and I didn't see the other movie that he references, something called Anguish, which he said he directly lifted the way of making the movie and the camera work. Was for the 80s section. The first act was all based on the feeling of audition, and I forgot what the third one was. It was definitely Anguish and Audition were the two main movies that inspired him.
Nice, thank you.
Hello, I would like to ask you a question. You've been talking about spec script. Can I ask you if you can go a bit more in details about what is it, the difference between the
A spec script is just a script written on speculation that they can get it made, which is anyone who's sitting back in a coffee shop typing up a script. It's something that hasn't been paid for. It's just in the writer's mind to hopefully win a lottery ticket, actually, just like by writing a script and hoping that somebody will make it.
The difference between is spec and
assignment.
An assignment is basically that the studio, the financier, a producer, hires a writer and pays him to write a screenplay. A spec is that anybody who has an idea in their head can sit in their room in a coffee shop and write it. And then when it finishes, it's a spec screenplay. And then, you know, you're looking to who you can send it to, you know, who can get it made, or for an agent or a manager that will like it and represent it, and so on and so forth. And as he said, start with the assistant of those people and get them all fired up. And if they like it, they will help you. They will go to the boss and say, I just read a fantastic script. which I've done many times when I started.
Yeah, so the three movies that we released this year, Watcher, Barbarian, and Don't Worry Darling, were all spec scripts. So it's just like, so one day it was just sent to us, and I read them all and liked all three scripts.
Thank you.
And then before you know it, it's like shooting. Everybody else is waiting 5 years, slugging through drafts and redrafts and director drafts that go nowhere, and then the director leaves, and then you have to get another director, and then the star leaves, and then you know, you hire another star, and she and the director then fall in love, and then basically, is that exactly what?
Hey, well, every project's different. Yes.
What would you say is the quality that you have that was in the most instrumental in your career? The success of your career?
Maybe it would be the confidence in, well, no, even confidence with the ability to pick movies that people wanted to see, and confident that I could push them through. Because if you don't have the right ability to pick the right projects, then doesn't matter how confident, if you have a couple of big flops, then Right. Nobody's gonna pay attention to you.
Right.
And I guess it's just having a commercial instinct of being able to read something and think that I could picture that in a way that would be something that could be watched by a lot of people and enjoyed by a lot of people.
But a lot of it, especially in the horror movie, came from you also being a fan of that genre.
Yes. So just like as I read it, I was like, I want to see this. And like when I read Barbarian, it was like I wanted to see it made.
Right. What are your next project, if you can talk about it, or in general?
I have several that it depends on. Like, I have
he has about 10, and 9 of them are going to get me.
Yeah, it's a lot of like a couple of them are straight to series orders and shows or movies that I just know that are going to get made, but I don't have any specific one other than the one I'm probably most excited about is a movie called Psycho Killer. And it's a script, and I got it because I just been hounded my favorite, right? But the person who wrote one of my favorite movies, Seven, and I was like, yes. Can you? I just want to see your follow up serial killer movie. And finally, he gave me a script that another one where everyone passed on, and but then the company that financed Barbarian was like, if you just let us know what else you want to make. And I was like, I want to make this. And now we're going to cast the lead from Georgina in Psycho Killer.
Now it's already easy. He's just cycling everybody. So I want to tell you something. The other thing that from my experience that I think can tell why he's so successful as a producer is I send out an invitation, either the end of that day or the next day. He said yes, sent a couple of dates, date was chosen, and here he is. The whole process took like 4 or 5 days. So you see somebody who is decisive, who also keeps his word. He showed up here, he showed up on time, he didn't try to change the dates, he didn't have all kind of excuses. He went for it and stayed with it, and it got done. And that is something that I can tell you from experience is what also defines somebody as successful as him. So I want to tell you that we are all big fan of yours. We are thrilled that you said yes. I think for you to make time to come and give students advice, help them with share your experience with them. I think it's incredibly helpful, and I think it's very egalitarian of you. And we thank you very, very much for coming, and we wish you continued success.
You're welcome.
For coming.